Hello, everybody. Welcome to Drunk with Questions, the talk show where ordinary people talk about extraordinary people. I'm your host, Gooch. Thanks for hanging out with us today. With me today is a guy, is the only guy that I've ever cuddled in bed with. Raj, how you doing today?
It was a wonderful experience. I'm doing well. For those of that you that don't know this, me and Mike have a pact that if we're not with our significant others by the time we're 40, we're getting married.
Yeah, true. Gotta reap them benefits, man.
Those tax benefits, bro.
So much tax benefit.
Oh, daddy.
Oh, man. Well, today we have Spicy and Tim with us. What's up, guys?
Doing well.
Yeah, doing well. Look Stop forward to another interesting conversation.
Yeah, I'm excited for this conversation. Prehistoric animals. You know, like your favorite. Maybe we'll get into some crazy voodoo bullshit.
If you're growing up and dinosaurs weren't your favorite, you're lying.
True.
Can I tell a quick story about when I was in first grade?
Yes.
So we watched this movie about dinosaurs, right? And like, you know how little kids are, like you really get into the movie type thing, right? So after this, me and this other kid, I can't even tell you what his name is, but we decided to start fighting each other in the back corner of our classroom because we were pretending that we were dinosaurs. And like both of us had this mutual agreement. Like this was a mutual fight between the two of us. And we got in trouble from our teacher and she said, "You guys are not dinosaurs. You need to cut it out right now."
What a story.
Yeah.
What a story.
So know? I'm not a dinosaur.
Yeah.
Way to leave us on a cliffhanger there.
Yeah. So she just, I mean, how old are you in first grade? Like six or something?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Right. Probably. Like, so she ruined my 6-year-old dreams about me being a dinosaur.
Sorry, man. That probably changed your entire life, too.
Yeah.
Right? Your whole projection from then.
Yeah. I've had an identity crisis ever since I was 6 years old.
Tim, you want to let the audience know what special ed school you went to?
Oh,
yeah, the special ed school of hard knocks.
Oh my God.
Just, no dinosaurs allowed.
It's a hard knock life for us. We're all gingers and skinny for us.
It was a good time.
Oh man.
Okay.
Remember, they said you can be anything you want to be, but you can't be a dinosaur.
It's true.
Sorry, yeah. Man. So if we restart this, hey to all our listeners, welcome to the roast of Tim.
No restart. This is all getting put in.
Yep.
Screw That's monetization.
Right. There's no restart.
It works.
The unbridled fury that is this talk show.
So I guess one of the more important things to solidify here is that there is a timeline to the Earth, as if our listeners don't know. So the Earth is kind of split up into, it's really four major sections. So you have your Precambrian, which is like when the Earth was made to about 542 million years ago. The Paleozoic, which is all the water critters that you see the cool documentaries on, like the crazy like scorpion fish and Dunkleosteus, things that I'll talk
good
about.
Seafood.
Trilobites. Yep. Yeah. Probably would be crazy to go fishing on that time frame. Could you imagine?
Oh my God.
I think you would be the bait.
Yeah.
You would not return.
So that would be your Paleozoic. And then about 252 million years ago, the Mesozoic started. That was after a giant extinction. That's when we start seeing like plants on the actual terrain. We start seeing dinosaurs show up later into that. We have another giant extinction, which I think all scientists have agreed was a meteorite now, right? It's not the volcano thing. Pretty sure everyone has agreed that it was a meteorite.
Yeah, I mean, the consensus as far as I've read up on is that, I mean, it went from volcano to tidal wave to meteor shower to some other like earthquake level event, but the most common one that keeps getting thrown out there is a meteor.
Yeah, so I think that actually has been solidified. I watched a documentary not too long ago where they were like, yeah, that's
pretty much the most likely.
Sure, that's what it was. So the meteor hit caused just a gigantic plume of earth crust to go into the atmosphere, ended up sending the Earth into like darkness for 5 years or something crazy like that. And because of that darkness, the plants died, the herbivores died, and thusly, the carnivores died. Small mammals were able to survive. That's when we start into the Cenozoic. And slowly but surely, mammals start taking over. We have the Ice Age in there during the Miocene and the Pleistocene. And then humans showed up about 10,000 years ago, and here we are.
Yeah, don't want to forget about the most recent extension, the Anthropocene extinction event that's just kicked off that has been classified. So as scientists are looking into it, it looks like we've entered into another extinction period where a lot
humans
of Earth's
are causing it.
Yeah.
Yay.
A lot of Earth's species are dying off, and you know, at the very end, the food chain can only hold so much.
You're like talking about like all the endangered species and stuff that are moving into the extinction level.
Yeah, pretty much the amount of extinction happening in terms of the species, because like even when like the dinosaurs and like those things happened because of a violent event that happened.
Oh yeah, so it was a mass crash level event.
This is slower, so we might not notice it as much. But when they look at the actual count of species that are dying off, it's getting faster and faster at a more rapid rate. And eventually, you know, there's going to be a tipping point where there's no going back, and the next extinction happens.
There's some that are going to make it and some that aren't.
Just not, yeah.
True.
Global warming is a topic for another day. I'm going to try and keep quiet.
Yep.
Well, so this doesn't focus specifically on that. I mean, it's
there's
I
a
mean,
lot it of change.
It's say. Like removing of habitats, like cutting down
Hot
certain
pollution.
Habitats.
Yeah.
Just migration of human settlement into like previously undeveloped areas.
Damming of rivers that actually have tributaries that lead to a lot of different places, not just the main source that they're trying to take stuff to. So we are doing more than enough. We don't need anything else on top of it.
Fair. All right, let's see here. Oh, God, that's how big they were? Oh, my God. Here, look at this.
That's what she said.
Boo.
Boo.
Boo. I had to.
Welcome right. back to the roast of Tim.
Look how old ancient coelacanths were.
Oh, my.
Oh, they look like groupers, dude. They look like the groupers nowadays.
They do.
Yeah.
Well, actually, and the thing I think of immediately when I see that image is the really large Amazonian river fish that you see in some of the zoos and aquariums.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the Arapaima.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you're... Because they have the similar tail structure where it's not...
Yeah, they have
tail.
A very similar like fin structure.
Yeah. Because the pictures to the left, Mike, those aren't coelacanths, are they? Because that's a different dinosaur altogether.
Yeah.
That is even more terrifying.
So anyways,
do you think
its
bottom jaw split like that to eat larger prey like a snake?
Yes. A snake? Yeah, yeah.
Snake. It's like a snake. You know what that reminds me of? That's a bigger snake head.
Yeah. Because like snake's jaws can like...
Snake head is all bone at the top, though.
Yeah.
They have to, it's like catfish.
That thing is gnarly looking.
But let's talk about coelacanths. So who wants to tell the story of coelacanths?
Definitely not I, because I don't know the story.
You don't know the story about the coelacanth?
No.
Or maybe I've heard it.
Oh,
and
you
I've
don't
forgotten.
Know either, Raj?
No.
I guess you're going to be the one to share it there, Mike.
Let's start time with Mike.
Boy. Hey, look at that. My
fisheries and wildlife.
Okay, so coelacanths, right? Lobe-finned fish. We talked about this, I think, in the last episode, correct?
About how bees are not fish.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, lobe-finned fish, Sarcopterygii. So, ancient coelacanths, which are like the picture that we have up right now, which were considerably larger, apparently. The ones that are around the human are the ones that we know of that are, like, still alive today. Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So they found fossils of coelacanths way back, I think it was like mid-1800s. Okay. And they're like, oh, look at that. This is interesting. This fish, I mean, I kid you not, I'll show you a picture. So this is the creepy part of it. So they actually have bones inside of their fins, like fingers, like an arm. It's super creepy. And they're kind of coming to the conclusion that these were that stepping stone between ray-finned fish and amphibians, right?
Mm.
So they found these fish, and they're like, see, look at that, Actinopterygii, Sarcopterygii. Oh, man, it's like I know what I'm talking about. Anyways, so they knew that coelacanths were kind of part of that stepping stone, but they thought that they were extinct because they had found fossils of them. And then all of a sudden, off the coast of Africa, this fisherman hauls in his catch, and he throws a coelacanth onto the ground, and this British scientist that just happened to be there was like, no way. This is like in 1876. She was like, no way is that a coelacanth. So she wasn't able to save the specimen, so she had to get it taxidermized because of the heat and everything like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it took another 20 years before another one was pulled up, and they were able to study it. They proved that it was a coelacanth, and then another variation of it was caught in the 1940s in Indonesia. So this is literally a fish that they classified as extinct. And then 100 years later, they were like, this is not an extinct species. It's just very elusive.
Do you think it's a rarity, or is it just elusive species altogether? Like,
they're relatively rare.
Okay.
So, I mean, they hide pretty well. There's probably that first one would be my guess.
Coelacanth.
Or maybe it's the second one, the 1939. So
nice.
Yeah. So these are fish that they just were like, there's no way that they're still alive. And then sure enough, here she is.
Sure enough.
There's the British scientist that found it.
Nice.
Very first one. And it's taxidermized, you can see, because the head looks like shit.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
Oh, wow.
So this was an extinct fish that is no longer extinct. Crazy, yep. Isn't it?
They're like, they're not here. Nope. No. Never mind. We found them.
We found them.
There are some extinct species that people are saying that they're seeing out in the world. I know the thylacine is one of them that they're saying is out there, and they've had like, is that a Yu-Gi-Oh card? I want that Yu-Gi-Oh card.
Super ancient deep sea king.
It's got 2800 attack points, dude. He's a savage.
But yeah, there's one of the fossils right there. Yeah.
It basically looks
exactly the same as the living thing. It's creepy.
Yeah. Pro tip, you can't legally sell the fossil, but you can sell them as a trading card game.
Yes. So remind me, you might know this, Mike. Uh-huh. A fossil, when we look at it, it is basically the imprint on the stone, right? It's not the actual fossil that we're seeing.
It depends on what you're talking about. So for fish, whose bones were generally more fragile, or birds, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or hollow boned animals would be a better way to say it.
Okay.
Or cartilaginous fish, so rays, sharks, things that did exist that we know still exist.
Mm-hmm.
If you find it like this, what has occurred is that's actually sediment, because in order for a fossil to happen, you have to have like the perfect everything, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when this fish died, in theory, it died probably in some very aggressive manner. It probably didn't just float to the bottom, because it would have probably gotten eaten, right? Mm-hmm. And destroyed.
Yeah.
So it probably maybe got crushed by a rock. Maybe it died and then somehow immediately got covered up by some sort of sediment.
Mm-hmm.
So the bones that we see in this fossil aren't actually the bones. They're just sediment that filled in where the bones were.
Yeah, okay. If I'm not mistaken, isn't it like a petrification process sometimes? Yes. Almost, where it's like a demineralization of the bones that's then replaced with like a calcification of it?
Well, that's actual fossils. This is literally, that's just
sediment. I got
like, you could in theory just scrub that with like a wire brush and it would just go away.
That's
so you got to be really careful with these types of fossils, fish, hollow boned animals, cartilaginous fish.
Now, yeah, actual it'll just bones, dissipate.
Yeah, so actual bones, like from dinosaurs and stuff, that's what you're talking about, where the calcium in the bone got replaced by some sort of a mineral. I'm not familiar with what kind. I'm sure a particular mineral is better than others. Now that you could take a wire brush to it and you wouldn't go through it at all. It's literally hard as a rock.
It's stone, basically.
Yeah. Mm. So this is an imprint versus an actual like physical rock.
Fossil. Okay.
I always thought too, it was fascinating the process of so like quick backstory as a child, like my career
smashed by a rock, Jesus Christ.
Oh, you're not kidding. That dude has a that's
a flat, got, you got a little fucked up, guys.
That's a flat boy fishing. Right there.
You wanna go fishing, guys?
That's a Pokemon. That's not even an actual thing. Oh
yeah,
God.
But no. So back in like elementary school, I mean, my chosen career path was like, I'm gonna go be a paleontologist. Like, same. I knew the word. I'm like, I'm gonna go find dinosaur bones. 2022. That's not really a lucrative like career choice.
No, it's actually really hard to. You know what the most of these civilian anthropologists are doing right now? They're in like areas where they're building buildings and they're making sure there's no fossils there. That's basically their job. So in like California, they found a whale species from like a long time ago, right where they were building a building. So they had to like stop all the processes, excavate it out, and pull the bones out so they could study it. And like most of the time, you're just surveying the area to make sure it's not a possible sediment site that could hold fossils.
Most
guys don't do like going out into the desert and searching for T-Rex skulls. That just doesn't happen nowadays.
Correct. Well, and honestly, too, I always thought it was such a fascinating process when you actually watch either on a documentary or such of the process of actually going through and finding this, uncovering the fossil, and then casting the fossil to take it back and then build essentially a reconstruction that you would have in a museum.
Oh, speaking of that, I know I talked to you guys about this before. So I want to talk about the story of Ogden and Marsh. These are the two guys that were like at the head of fossil discoveries and discovering these new species. Cause you know, back in the day when they found a giant bone, they thought they found like, you know, some like giant's remains. Oh, they didn't really realize what they were looking at. Like we said, they find elephant heads and they think that they're cyclopses because of the eye socket like spacing in their head. So these guys were basically going at each other. They were both well-known. It wasn't Ogden and Marsh. It's Marsh and Cope. Marsh and Cope are the guys. So they were basically predominant scientists in their field in terms of finding these bones. And what they would do is they would go on to all these excavations. And now you're thinking, nowadays we can like sonar map and we can do all kinds of stuff to figure out where these things are located, you know, but they were basically just going to a place and just digging until they find stuff. One of the funniest things about them is they got so competitive about finding these fossils is that they would then start just making stuff up. They would be like, oh, this one leg looks like it's a little bit different from the other ones, like even though one could just be a hind leg and a forward leg from the same animal, and they'll just classify it as another animal. They'll just build a whole skeleton around it with no purpose, and they'll classify it as a different animal. So like they have to go through nowadays and actually look at a lot of work that these guys did and kind of discount some dinosaurs. I don't know if you remember when we were growing up, you know, there was a huge disparity between like a brachiosaur and another form of those long neck dinosaurs. They realized that one is actually just a juvenile version of the other. And they're just like, these aren't two separate dinosaurs. They're the same, just a juvenile version of the other. So like these guys were just going out and digging. I mean, they weren't digging themselves. They had, I'm sure, this is the, what year is this? The 1872s. They had minorities digging for their bones. They had the ethnic group in the area that they were digging for their bones.
And if you're a kid born in the 90s and you're telling me the Land Before Time and Littlefoot were not your favorite, you're lying to me.
Those are also sad movies.
Okay, they might be. Tim, don't ruin it.
But like kind of speaking about like skeletons and them not really knowing like what it is, you know, that's misidentified all the time. I know that there's a meme going around at one point of a rabbit skeleton, and then it was like how scientists would describe the animal, and it was like this real butchered drawing of the animal, and then like the photo of the real animal. So they weren't accounting for a lot of things like fat that the animal may have, dietary restrictions and environment and all these other things. So I mean, everything's like,
right,
you can go off of some type of theory about what they really look like, but
yeah. Do you guys know the saying, the tongue twister, she sells seashells by the seashore?
Oh yes.
Yeah. Do you know where that comes from?
Probably a girl named Sally who sold seashells.
No.
By the seashore.
No, no. So it was inspired by a young girl from Dorset. She was out collecting shells and came upon an entire fossilized skeleton of a dinosaur on the side of a cliff.
Dude, that's sweet.
And she also later found more prehistoric specimens that have been credited by modern scientists as the founder of, like, some of the stuff that she found. Like, she is, so it says on this, she later discovered several more prehistoric specimens and has been credited by modern scientists as the founder of modern paleontology.
Interesting.
Some girl just walking around collecting seashells and finds a Tyrannosaurus Rex on the side of a cliff.
Yep. Well,
how come this never happens to me?
That's the beginning of Lara Croft Tomb Raider right there.
So look at this. This is a perfect example.
Yeah.
It's, I love so these. True, though.
How aliens are reconstructed, because this skull looks just absolutely ferocious.
So for all the viewers, it's the skull of a hippopotamus, and they're saying how aliens would reconstruct it if they were like our paleontologists. And it looks like just this absolutely demonic, like, look at the skull of a hippopotamus creature. You can see. And then we were like, yeah, no, it's just a hippo.
It's just a happy little hippo. He's
a hamster.
But dude. I mean, if you think about it, you could see where they could go completely wrong.
Yeah.
It's completely accurate. No worries.
And then the one with the kitten is actually pretty funny.
Oh, the platypus.
Hold on. Is that Zool?
Zool. It might be, yeah. Yeah,
oh, my goodness. Funny.
The platypus one.
Where's the platypus?
Down my...
Oh, yeah, the skull.
It's Cthulhu. It's a platypus skull, and
bro, you know that looks like the thing from Mandalorian, the sigil from Mandalorian. That's what
it
that
does.
Like. Oh my god, the orca!
Oh no!
They just have the bad guy and the alligator bad guy from Spider-Man.
My god,
it just looks so dumb with the rest of it. I'm telling you, stuff is so much scarier with just the bone.
Oh yeah,
you just don't know. Like,
oh, there's your tardigrades.
Yes, those things are the coolest things, man. Tardigrades are like everywhere. They're on you at all times. They're in all. Stop!
That's bad.
All right. Okay, we're done.
Tardigrades.
Super cool creatures. They're also known as water bears. They're really little, tiny, tiny creatures that you would not be able to see without an actual microscope. They are able to survive in the vacuum of space. There are certain theories out there that the tardigrades are like some of the originating species, and they traveled via asteroid.
Well, you know what? Planets. China accidentally crashed a spaceship onto the moon that was full of tardigrades, and they're not sure what happened afterwards. So there could be a bunch of tardigrades living on the moon right now.
I thought they go into stasis, though, if they're in space.
They do. Yeah. They do. They go into stasis in space. If there's no water or oxygen, they'll just go into a stasis mode, and they will just drift in space until they come across whatever they need. They can go for a long time without any food or water.
They do look like a little bear, but with a butthole as a face.
Yeah. Yeah. Look at the face as it opens up, though.
That is terrifying.
Yeah.
Water it looks bear. Like that creature that came out and ate Boba Fett.
Yeah, it does look like a Snarlax.
Yeah, Snarlax. Look at it, it's so cute. When it's like an otter when it doesn't have its face unpeeled.
Unpeeled? Nice.
Oh, God, yeah, no. No, no, no. No, thank you. Oh, God, the eyes, no.
Yeah.
So crocodiles are also something that's been around for a long time. And we look at them, we're just like, oh, they're just crocodiles, but they're literally just miniature dinosaurs.
Literally. I mean, if you want the best, let's see what some ancient crocodiles look like.
Oh, what was that called? The 40-foot long one. That one was my coolest.
On the land? Yeah, that thing was scary, bro.
Yeah, that was a 40
foot.
Yeah,
this fucker.
Yeah.
A galloping crocodile.
No, nope.
No, see, thank you.
No,
there
thanks.
Was a there was another one that was, man. Oh my god, what is it called?
They galloped. That is terrifying.
Well, crocodiles can chase you down. Don't be fooled. Like, they are actually pretty fast in the
yes.
That's actually, why you I just think... smack them in the face with a cast iron pan.
Well, because I don't know if it's true with modern
video.
Crocodiles, but actually alligators, I think they run at like a 30-mile-an-hour land speed briefly.
Oh, yeah, they're pretty quick.
So good luck.
It was called a Ramphosaurus. I forget what it... Could you look that up, Mike? R-H-A-M-P-H-O-S...
Here it is right here.
Yeah, there it is. No, that's a bird.
No, that's a bird.
With a, it's Phosuchus.
My question is, why did they have to make all the names so difficult to say?
It's got to be scientific. Leave it alone.
Yeah, man. It's a science name.
Oh, my God. 11
yeah.
meters?
40 feet. School bus.
So, even though it was
you
kind of
a... You could stand
probably,
in its mouth when it's open. Like, a six-foot person could stand in its mouth. When it's open on the banks,
you know what I that kind of looks like, though? The gar, I don't know how to say it. Gharial.
Gharial?
Yeah.
Gharial. Yeah. So that's the fish eating cousin.
Okay,
we have those where I'm from. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's a doll. Never mind.
Yeah, but that's that tooth. No, just all nopes. This is everything
is.
Sci-fi.
Look at
yeah,
that.
Man.
This is everything Sci-Fi Channel tells me not to mess with.
Well, because they made that really like offshoot like kind of B-list movie where they had the giant crocodile fighting Titanoboa, which is one of my favorite prehistoric animals.
The Titanoboa, yes.
Yeah.
That
are we
was,
all
that's
in agreement that if some of these animals had been alive when humans were trying to come about, that we probably just wouldn't have made it?
We would not have made it.
Nope. Well, here's
like,
the thing.
Come on, dude. What are you going to do?
Our ancestors wouldn't have made it. The small rodents and creatures that would rely on being able to survive would not make it because, well, I don't know. Maybe we would just delayed how much time it took for us to evolve because these things would eventually have to die out, right?
We would have just always been away from the water.
Yes. You know that crocodiles can technically are only limited by, I think, the area in which or the food that they eat.
It's oxygen, so can, too.
And oxygen levels. Yeah. They can get to insane proportions as long as they just eat. It's the same thing with insects. The reason insects are so small now is because of the oxygen in the atmosphere. So if there's more oxygen in the atmosphere, we can have insects the size of dogs.
That was one thing that I was going to mention. Yeah, the estimated level of oxygen at the time of these animals was significantly higher than what it currently is on Earth.
Yeah. There's just no way for that's my whole thing about these like giant cryptids being around. Like, it's like, oh, they're in the water. It doesn't really no, it does matter because the amount of oxygen in the atmosphere has a direct correlation with the amount of oxygen in the ocean, too. Like it's not like one is separate from the other. So for these kind of animals to survive, it would be almost impossible.
I want to talk about some of the leaps that we take sometimes too, because I mean, I guess they're not leaps, but you're really, when you only find the femur of an animal, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then they come out with like, here, I'll show you an example, like a super incomplete skeleton. And we're just like, oh yeah, that's exactly what it looked like.
Yeah.
Because some of the dinosaurs that we know of, we only have like two teeth and like a femur.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
but don't they rely on similar
this thing?
Mm-hmm.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bone fragments, and they're claiming you can see the silhouette if you look at it really hard. They're claiming
now,
you know exactly what it looked like.
Now I can assume that there's other fuller skeletons out there that are comparing this to, right?
I don't think so. I'm pretty sure that they feel confident enough nowadays that if they find just a handful of bone fragments, that they can recreate an entire animal just based off of those. And I think that's a pretty large leap, man.
That's a big leap for me to believe. Like, the amount of expertise it would take, like, you could find a human bone out there, and unless you know exactly what you're looking at, you could walk past it and never realize. It's just the way it is. Like, finding a small piece of the leg is not going to tell you what the majority of the animal is going to be like. One.
They've only found the skull, most of the spine, and the rear hip. And they're just assuming they know what the front leg looks like.
I mean, you could estimate that based on what the hind leg was like. And you can look at the size of the head and how much weight it would be and how it would have to carry it.
Man, dude.
It's one of those things that, like, I could see with enough data and fossilization how you could be like, okay, this is like our best guess of what it looks like. But I mean, if you've got like two vertebrae and like a leg bone, like it is a pretty, like, you basically got a dude in there playing with an Etch-a-Sketch trying to come up with something cool.
So there you go, the T-Rex, the white is what they found.
Yeah,
correct.
So you have the giant skull, so you basically know how much weight this head is going to have. You can tell by the size of the feet how much, if it has these tiny arms and all of its weight is on its feet, you knew the feet had to be ginormous and they'd have to have giant quads. It would also tell you that it needs a giant tail.
True.
To counterbalance his head. Yeah.
I mean, there are like scientific portions of that, yes, anatomically, that we can surmise that, like, probably physics based, this would have to be part of it.
Yeah. Because physics hasn't changed since the dinosaurs have been around. It's the same. There's no more gravity now than there was before. So, like, we can tell how the mechanics would have to work.
But I do tend to agree with Mike that there are a lot of times that I think we take too big of a leap with some of this, because it's like there's not a lot of good basis for some of these, like, renderings. Mind you, they're not saying this is gospel, but...
Yeah. And a lot of the times with these kind of fossils, they're always making changes to it. And they'll find something, like, for the longest time, they thought that the T-Rex had terrible eyesight. And it wasn't until recently they discovered that that can't be possible, because the way the eye sockets are designed on a T-Rex, it had one of the best eyesights in anything that walked the planet. It had the best sight of any predator on the planet at the time that it was around. And because they thought that it had bad eyesight, they decided, oh, it was slow and cumbersome, and it was most likely a scavenger, which is also proven to be not true, because generally great eyesight means that it's a predator and it hunts. And that's most likely what it did. It could do large amounts of distances. It's with the amount of weight, like, you look at it and you think, oh, that can only run for like 10 seconds at a time. But I mean, elephants are gigantic and they can run for miles and miles. You'd be surprised. Like, it doesn't mean that they're going to be slow and cumbersome.
Here's a weird thing that I thought of just like looking at the T-Rex skull. Just think about this. Like, just imagine it. The eyeballs are where the nose is, and the nose is where the eyeballs are.
Huh?
What?
Just think about it.
Could be.
So the big holes in the front eyeballs give you like a interesting range. I don't know. I don't know why that thought crossed my mind.
So but the T-Rex eyes look really weird. Aren't actually like pointing to the sides though, because they're hunters. They're pointed straight forward.
Yeah.
So there wouldn't be no need for it to be, because let's see, in this drawing, it looks like his eyes are pointing on each side and he has to turn his head.
But they're right here. That's the actual hole right there.
Yeah.
They're facing out.
They're facing out towards the front. So they could be looking at you and still be able to hunt you down.
I mean, and that shows you that T-Rex probably did descend from a herbivore, though, because you can tell that he's in a point where his eyes aren't necessarily in the front. Like, they're still kind of off to the side a little bit.
Yeah.
T-Rex...
but is that a herbivore thing? Because that's more classified nowadays as an herbivore thing, but back in the day, I mean, I'm sure most of the predators back then also had not perfectly front eyes.
To give them like a wider field of view, but I feel like directly in front of them, if their eyes were like too far off,
we have to remember how new eyes were too. In this time frame.
Oh, new eyes were.
No, Hey, it's 10.
No, that statement says a lot. Remember how new eyes were. Like, if we're going to discuss this, remember the eyes were just invented. What were they doing before the prehistoric period?
Do I have to give you a whole eye class right now?
The interesting thing, though, think of how large the occipital like lobe could be on a dinosaur. When you like look at a turkey, for example, like turkeys are really dumb birds, but their eyesight is absolutely incredible.
Yeah, because they can see, because the issue was it the transition of eyes happened in water. Water is where all the eyesight, everything, all the senses developed. Yep. And then the hard part is transitioning from the lenses that you had for eyesight underwater to then going into land where you don't have the water filtering all the light. But that's where the major step in eyesight changed.
Dude, eyes literally started with cells being like, I can identify when it's bright and when it's not. That's how simple it was. Oh, it's bright. Oh, it's not. All right. Up is down. Down is up. That's pretty much what it was trying to tell them, is because the sun was always above them pretty much, right? So they would be able to tell if they were upside down or what side of them was facing towards the bottom and what side was facing up towards the top of the sea. I feel like that was wrong to say it that way, but I did.
Yes. But I liked it.
And then they were able to tell if it was daytime or nighttime. Like, that's how simplistic this is. And there's still animals today that have just light sensitive spots.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
Yeah.
And then the cells are like, all right, we're going to start enclosing in ourselves. And that's the abalone right there who can actually determine whether or not it's not that they can see. It's just that they can perceive it better, would be a better way to say it. And then you get a fluid filled cavity like the Nautilus there. Now you can start actually seeing stuff. It's going to be like really crappy. Like everything's going to be blurry, but just the ability to see movement around you is huge. Cause then, you know, like, oh man, something fast just moved by me. That's probably not friendly.
You and know, then walk away. Yeah.
Yeah. You're just like, this is a danger zone.
I have a very serious question for everyone since I just joined.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Have we talked about dinosaurs and how you would fight them yet?
Not yet.
Oh, okay.
I'm down for it.
I have a lot of dinosaur fighting theories. I think a lot about how I'd fight a dinosaur.
I thought he was I have experience in this.
No. I've given it a insane amount of thought. Like modern animals and prehistoric animals all around, like I've given a lot of thought how I would fight one.
He's like, I'm a bit of a sage on the game.
So you say dinosaurs. Now, what type of dinosaurs are you willing to fight? Because there are some that are just outside of the scope.
There are some that are outside of the scope.
Let's start with the Compi.
Okay, so those little fuckers?
Yeah.
Easy enough.
Kick it.
Didn't like 5 people die in Jurassic Park to these
guys? Well, if we're going off based off Jurassic Park, yes. So obviously that basic ass armor, even like a gambeson, that kind of padding, they wouldn't be able to bite through it. Their bite strength isn't strong enough to get through any kind of thick clothing.
Hell,
like
would
zombie,
you even need anything?
Zombie stuff.
I mean,
if you're just wearing shorts and a t-shirt, they're going to fight chunks off you.
So without armor, Mike, honestly, if I threw you in a fighting ring without armor, without...
Yeah, fuck that. I wouldn't fight those things without armor. I just want to get nipped at.
If I threw you into an MMA ring with no clothes, nothing, and I put a rabid squirrel in the MMA ring with you, that squirrel would have a better chance. Because we are such children when it comes to fighting without weapons.
I mean,
so like you need some type of armor. Like
they're fast as fuck.
Yeah,
with a shotgun.
With how thin their necks were, I mean, like at the same time, like it would.
Are we talking one on one, or are we talking a bunch to one? Because one on one, no.
I think for the Compi, we're gonna have to say at least 10. Right,
10 on one.
10 on one.
That's gonna be rough.
That's gonna be rough.
Are they good at working together?
There is no scientific proof that these things moved in herds. It was only a Jurassic Park thing where they showed them moving in herds.
I'm just saying, for their size, we gotta say,
of course not.
We put them in a union together. They're unionized. Yeah. They're working together, and they're going to take you down with 10 of them.
I feel like they'd be more of a scavenger type dinosaur.
Yeah,
because they're not
even
really...
know their choice. A scavenger will still fight.
Yes.
Yeah.
Back it into a corner. It's going to fight.
Like I would raccoon. Say for those. I mean, I'm not as worried about armor. I mean, if they're coming at you, just a quick machete job will do it.
Exactly. I believe that's a win for the humans. We could fend off many of those and also survive off them. Like those little fuckers, they're probably good eating, man.
You think they taste like chicken?
Maybe. Which they taste a lot like squirrel.
Yeah. We gotta find an accurate picture of a velociraptor. That's
are we gonna go like from smallest to largest animal, how you would fight them?
Yes.
Okay. Yep.
I love this.
This is a velociraptor.
I'm gonna take like another 2 shots before I
talk. Why does that one look like a bird?
Because that's what they look like.
That's a horrible drawing. No, like the cartoonish looking one.
Oh, yeah. That's just...
No, that's the one next to it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Roughly the size of a turkey.
Velociraptor, roughly the size of a turkey?
But turkeys will do some damage.
I mean, oh, yeah. Turkeys will fuck you up.
Here's the thing.
So the most damage comes from the feet. The feet, that claw. The claws. That's what does the damage. It's not the teeth as much as like what they can do with just these. Now these are pack hunters.
Yeah.
These will hunt in packs. They're imagine basically turkeys if they were acted like
wolves. If we're and if also let's just throw that all technology is like in the works, anything that you can wield and carry, but I'm gonna impose one rule on this. So the rule is it has to be stuff that's not gonna encumber you. So if you're like, all right, I'm gonna carry like a 50 cal or something like
emotional
that.
Support tank.
Yeah, you're gonna yeah, something like that. Like it's gotta be something that you could conceivably carry, and like let's just say there's a post-apocalyptic world where dinosaurs come back that we're looking at, like you have to be able to kind of function with it to a degree. So you have to be able to carry it, and you have to be able to move a distance and survive in said like with said equipment. It's not just
at
like
the,
a,
at the end, can we also decide what caliber of bullet would be required to take this animal down?
Sure,
absolutely.
Sure, the I think kill that yeah. So just remember that I think I feel like that's the only parameter you set. So it's not just gonna be like, all right, yeah, just nuke it. No, we're not gonna play that game. We got to play like either hand-to-hand combat up into using firearms.
That's so I think for velociraptors, I could probably take on three with just a nice wooden stick.
Ooh, look at those claws,
with a nice
dude!
Wooden stick.
Look at the claws on it.
Yeah, like,
are you in full armor?
No, I'm talking.
Are you wearing anything at all?
No, me in normal clothes with a 6 foot long solid stick.
Clothes at
I
least.
I think I could take on three of them.
You need to be more specific when you say a nice wooden stick, because I was imagining you butt ass naked with a stick fighting off velociraptors. It's like no. Your dick's gonna get clipped right off, dude. It's gonna rip out your squishy bits.
So velociraptors can run at a top speed of estimated 25 miles per hour.
So I mean, we're not running from it; we're fighting it, Raj.
Yes, but if it's three of them, they're gonna run around you before 25 miles an hour. That thing would be doing circles around you.
Yeah, but the stick gives you like space because they gotta think
You're
about it.
Confident in a stick?
Yeah.
So I'm gonna.
It's not very big. You can see how big this thing is, bro.
I wouldn't fight that fucking thing with just
a
stick.
But that is not a turkey, my friend. That is a savage animal from the island of savagery. Like.
If we're talking about upping the ante or like going from like, you know, early weapons to like firearms, things would be required. I mean, I would up it from maybe a stick, like a quarter staff
to a baseball bat.
No, I would go probably more of like a spear, like an obsidian bladed spear.
Maybe go into the Bronze Age, Mike, and not just in like the Neanderthal era.
I'm gonna raise you one thing I'd be comfortable with, Spicy, instead of a spear. I would raise you a glaive. So something that had the ability to cut as opposed to just stab. Because if they're really fast, you're gonna miss a lot with a spear. Like if you're lined up with a spear and those things they're fast as fuck, so you're gonna miss a lot with a spear. I believe like a sweeping motion with a long bladed weapon, you'd be able to kill as many as you could until you got tired, I think, with some kind of like even basic armor, just some heavy clothing, even, I would say. Like
honestly,
again, a gambeson.
If you have a sword and shield and you back yourself into a corner, you're pretty good.
I think a shield would be too cumbersome for fast things like that. Absolutely not. Unless you're talking about a tower shield, and again, cumbersome. I think something that small, that fast, you'd have a really tough time wielding a shield against. I've given shields an insane amount of thought, like in a lot of contexts. They're cumbersome and they're meant to be used against intelligent creatures. That's my, because they can be intelligent creatures, like against another human, like someone that you're like, all right, they're going to target this. They're going to target this. Those things, they're relatively intelligent, but I think it would get in the way more than it would help you. And they're so fast that you wouldn't be able to react quick enough with it.
Yeah. Like,
I think a spear is the right way.
Or a glaive would be good.
A spear would be
I wouldn't discount the shield idea, because if you went with a small little buckler, you'd be okay.
Oh, well, if we're talking a buckler, you just punch one of those things in the head and kill it.
Yeah, because I was thinking of more like the Greek style round shields, the tiny ones that they used to, like the bronze arrow
ones. More close to a hoplon. No.
Yeah.
So those were the early on. No, but the bigger ones, like the ones that I think you're imagining. What ones are you talking about? Because like the ones that I'm imagining are the ones that are like bronze covered, strips of wood and cloth. And those cover you from literally neck to thigh. That wasn't a joke, or even below
me. No, no. I'm looking at like small round shields, like the stuff that you.
I think the buckler is the best call that I've heard so far. Well, like double bucklers, fuck, you'd absolutely rip those things up.
The biggest thing I'd want is those talons. I want a shield that if they jump at me, I can use that and it'll deflect their talons away from me.
I think that you could do the same thing with just wearing a gambeson. like a heavy pattern armor. Kevlar even would do it.
Yeah, stab but proof, I feel like if I have a sword armor and shield, I wouldn't feel the need to have a heavy cumbersome armor on.
Gamisons are not heavy, nor are they cumbersome, sir. That's just like wearing a coat. So you would be uninhibited at all. The only thing you got to worry about is heat with a gamison, because it's not good heat transfer. But yeah, gamisons, man, it's like literally wearing a heavy coat.
Okay, so what do you guys think? Buckshot?
Absolutely.
There you go. Buckshot will take care of it.
Close range shotgun.
Dude, I would hunt velociraptors. Like an actual velociraptor that size, I would hunt one.
I got a question for Timmy. Timmy,
yes.
If we gave you shotgun, birdshot, how many of those could you take out before they got to you? Let's just say you were in a space where there is, how many do you think you could take out as they're approaching you with at some distance on their way in?
What kind of shotgun is it?
What kind of shotgun do you want it to be? Because you have a shotgun.
And is it like your standard pump shotgun? Is it semi-auto shotgun?
What kind of shotgun would you have?
Is it like an AA-12?
You choose, Tim.
You choose.
God.
Like an auto. Jesus Christ. That's our next step right there. But yeah, how many could you take out, Timmy?
So I do like a semi-auto shotgun.
Okay.
With that magazine fed. Right.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. So if you say like, if you got the big magazine, so you got 10 rounds in a magazine. I feel like effectively maybe like 8 at least.
Effectively 8? I like that.
Yeah.
Given your tools of choice, Raj, how many of those little fuckers do you think you could take out?
If I go with a sword and buckler.
Is that what you would choose over some kind of firearm?
No, if I had a choice, I would use a firearm.
I'm saying with your choice of weaponry, like stuff that you are either able to use or could utilize very well. Like,
so I would definitely choose a shotgun because I'd want the spread, because I might not get right on them because they're fast. So if I can spread and I can just hit them with one or two, I'd probably use a shotgun with birdshot, honestly, just so I can get maximum spread.
Yeah, they're pretty small.
How many do you think you could take out with a shotgun of your choice?
Oh, if I have a shotgun, I can probably take out, what is it, 10 maximum 10 rounds.
It depends on the shotgun.
Probably like 4 if I get 2 shots on each, like missing a few.
Okay. Spicy, how many of those little fuckers would you be confident you could kill?
All of them.
Oh man.
with a tool of your choice.
Weapon is out of range.
Yeah, well, I think it just has to be something that you could work.
I mean, even from a
use and work
even
properly.
From a long bladed like pole weapon. I mean, I'm gonna say probably only like maximum 6. I mean, because of the fatigue setting in, trying to like chase after them and like a lot of wide swings because they're hopping all over the place. Okay. Firearm, shotgun. Even if you went with more of a semi-automatic rifle type deal, like an AR style platform,
I feel like it'd be difficult with an AR platform because they're fast, quick, and I feel like you'd miss a lot. That's my only. I was like, I like the spread idea.
Mm-hmm. It's honestly, I'd confidently say that. I mean, on a bad day, 8; on a good day, 12, depending on how many you could get with those guns. But other than that, you get any more than that, you're gonna get overwhelmed.
Yeah.
Gooch?
So buckshot.
I'm sticking with 3 quarterstaff.
3 and another quarterstaff?
He's not giving up on that. He all believes right in his quarterstaff ability.
Mike's like, I took down 3 of the pack and the 4th one.
One day when VR is way above us, I'll prove to you guys that.
I love it.
I love the
Velociraptors for the quarterstaff.
So I'm going to tell you guys right now, the next one coming up, you're not fighting it if you don't have guns.
Well, all right. I've got an interesting one for you on those small ones, though. So I would go with a dirk, like a Scottish dirk, like a long knife, and wear full armor and let them come at me and grab each of them and fucking shank it through with I'm talking like a 6-inch blade, so I would have no chance at missing. Also, there's no way those little fuckers are getting through any type of armor, especially like kind of armor that I own, where you're like even any kind of heavy leather or a splinted armor situation, mm-hmm, there's no way that they would be able to produce like that kind of force to bite through it or even massively injure you. So I'm thinking about like calmly letting those fucking things come up and bite me, however many that there are, and one by one pull them off and fucking cut their heads off or stab them right through the chest with like an inch and a half wide blade by maybe 6 inches. And so you're not looking about wasting any wasted energy at all. So I'm thinking confidently, I could take over a dozen of them, just letting them come up and bite on me, rip them off, and fucking just stab them.
Okay. So you're just going the violent. You just want violence.
Oh, yeah. I don't care, man. Okay. And at that point, and also consider how much blood would be on you at that point. You'd get real slicked up and lubed up. Those little fuckers couldn't even stay on you. Like, if you're drenched in the blood of their homies, there's got to be a point where they just give up. So, like, I take out a dozen of them easy, I think, with a full armor and a dirk. That's it. Nothing
else. I could see this man just wearing armor, holding a knife covered in little like, dinosaur blood, just being like, tell your friends.
Yeah, tell your friends not to fuck with me anywhere.
You just got to hope that they don't knock you over.
This is our next step.
Oh, yeah, this is the Utah Raptor.
Love this.
Now, they were in groups as well, so we're going to say minimum of four.
So, I'm going to meet Jesus.
Oh, also, since this is a podcast format, do we want to describe what we're seeing to our audience?
A Utah Raptor is the actual Velociraptors that you see in, like, Jurassic Park.
They're mischaracterized
in a feathered form.
Actually, I would say they're bigger. They're bigger than the ones they show in the movies. Because
these
movies,
are a little bit larger.
Yeah, the movies, they're generally, they stand smaller than
six meters long, 4 meters tall. That's quite a bit bigger, I believe, than what we see in any Jurassic Park movie.
It's 2 meters long, tall.
2 meters tall? I'm sorry.
4 meters
I read that wrong.
Would be gigantic.
I can't. Okay. Oh, God. Yeah, now I can see that. Sorry. I'm drunk and also have my glasses on. So 2 meters tall, 2 meters. 6 meters long.
So these things are fat. They're bigger. They're not faster than the other one, but they're fast enough. They're anywhere from 15 to 20 miles per hour on a trot. And these things are extremely intelligent, and they have been known to also hunt in packs. There's a famous skeleton of two of them fighting another dinosaur that got fossilized because it was a mudslide or a rock slide covered them up during mid-fight.
Do you know what type of dinosaur they were fighting?
It was an herbivore of some kind. Let me look.
Was it a larger herbivore, I assume? Because if we're talking one of those, like, if it's like a armor-plated, like, heavily, I don't know, what the hell are those little ones that are, they got like a mace for a tail? Those are my favorite dinosaur too. I can't believe I don't remember their name. If it's one of those, like, they're ballsy as fuck.
You're talking about an ankylosaurus.
Is that what I'm talking about? I love them.
Yeah. Little armored dudes.
Yes, they're my absolute favorite dinosaur.
Yeah, an ankylosaurus.
Yep. They're my fave.
Is it because they have a mace for a tail?
Yes. Is there another another fucking reason?
What was the other dinosaur that had a mace for the tail? Or like it had like a giant like ball on the end of its tail.
That was the armored one that had the ball. There was also the one that had the sails on the back with the giant spikes sipping out of it. The Stegosaurus.
Stegosaurus. I love Stegosaurus.
Stegosaurus had the big like spikes.
The heavily armored All right. This is great.
Oh, this is a death match between two Velociraptors.
Interesting.
Oh, a Velociraptor and a Protoceratops.
Protoceratops.
This is the one. I know the one you were talking about.
Yeah, there's one that has a.
But either way, are we starting with Timmy again?
Yes.
All right, Timmy. Bringing it back to our Velociraptor as we know it, what would you do? Would you kill one? How many would you kill?
AK-47 with a drum magazine.
How many?
Infinite ammo's cheat.
I don't know, man. Four of them coming at you?
Tim's like, this is Compton.
Well,
yeah, right? Yeah, because they worked in packs.
Yeah.
Okay, so are we assuming minimum of four working in a pack against us? Yeah, okay, are these the parameters that we're going to set on?
Yes, yeah. Okay.
As far as numbers?
Let's just say, could you defeat all four with the toolkit that you're imagining?
Now, this is assuming that you even see them coming.
Yeah. Because
these are ambush predators, and unlike wolves, you won't know until it's too late. So
what are the other parameters? Are we in a woods setting? Do we load into the woods? Yeah. Do we load into an MMA ring? What are we doing?
Let's just say you are in the middle of a field. These guys are running at you. They are, since they move about 20 miles per hour, they're visible to you.
Okay.
They're moving 20 miles an hour towards you, and they're about, let's say,
100 yards.
100 yards away.
Okay.
From the tree line.
Mm-hmm.
And you see them.
Yep.
And you see them, yep.
Roll my.
They're going to close that 100 yards
fucking
horrible. Fast.
Yeah.
Now, we could add tall grass for a
No, I don't think we need that.
Ooh, I don't know. I'd think at least like two of them.
I was
maybe
one.
Three.
Yep. One, maybe hurt two.
I don't know.
You could have hurt two. Because I feel like here's the thing. These are 7.62. Like it hits, it packs a wallop, but these things are probably just running after you looking to eat. Like they could take a licking and still walk around. Like,
so what's that? There's that giant rifle. I can't think of the name of it.
The elephant gun?
Yeah.
Yeah, but then you only get one shot per, though. So you have to shoot.
And it has to be like something that you can reasonably carry, right?
Yeah.
Well,
the thing is, too, elephant gun isn't really a rifle. It's a type of category of large caliber rifles.
Mm-hmm. What are they? It's not a 50, is it? Or is it bigger?
They're way
bigger. So a lot of times they get bigger. Like, it's all about the millimeter of the round and everything like that.
Can I bring a mortar?
All right. Well, who's that? What's your call, Timmy? What's your? Could you kill all four?
Probably not.
Given the proper tool set. Okay. No. How many?
Here's a couple safari rounds for you.
Oh.
Yep.
Yeah. Oh my god.
That's not even as big as they get.
That freaking 12 gauge rifle. So for me, I feel like it wouldn't be to kill them. It would be to scare them off.
Okay.
Because I think what I would do is I would get a shotgun, a magazine fed shotgun, and fill it with dragon's breath.
Okay.
And try to scare them off with the heat and the fire and then some of the like pellets. Because I feel like these things aren't used to dealing with fire. And if they see fire, they generally run from it. So if you can put enough fire in front of their face, with dragon's breath.
I don't think at what point would a dinosaur ever like experienced fire, like forest other fires. Than a forest fire.
Yeah,
other than anything that's like aggressive towards them. I feel like that'd be a very scary experience for a dinosaur, considering it's something that just doesn't happen all the time. So yeah. I can see that.
What about like
M60? It's not about killing. It's about surviving. Yeah, but you're dealing with a belt fed that would you need to like be in one place for, and you would need to like you can't run around with it as effectively as you can. Like M60s shoot what, like 308?
Yeah.
Yeah, 308.
What about like the a Vulcan minigun just in 5.56 with a backpack magazine?
Well, first of all,
are you talking about like some predator shit? Like like cutting down a whole forest line and screaming into it and hoping that you hit your target? I love that.
So
absolutely. It's been done. It's been proven to kill an alien hunter or wound it. So obviously you could kill some velociraptors. I'm totally with Timmy on that.
Yeah, but I mean, you're talking about you're cumbersome.
Correct. It's also not in a 5.56 variant.
Yeah. I would say you're definitely getting murdered, but you would take down.
You could take a few.
I'd say
my whole strategy is to just scare them enough to where they back up and they don't want any problems.
So Raj wants to live. Raj isn't talking about fighting. Raj's talking about.
I'm trying to you come across. Raj's trying to come across the next fight. You are literally trying to survive for your next fight. You are not trying to kill this thing. you are so, ready.
I mean, realistically,
yeah, what you got, Spicy?
Yeah, I mean, realistically, the minigun idea, like, it was cool in the movies, but that is super cumbersome. You don't just carry those around. They're also 30 calibers, not 5.56, so you're significantly up in your weight on that one. Honestly, this one, even with a good 7.62 or larger cartridge rifle, semi-automatic, you're going to be hard-pressed. You might kill one and, like, wound one or two more. But I'm ready to meet Jesus at this point.
Yep.
Yeah.
Like last stand situation.
Mike's bow staff is coming back.
Mike's like, fuck it. I'll give me a stick. I'll fight one.
Naked.
Yeah. We've all got our modern firearms. And Donatello over there is ready to fight him off with Master Splinter.
So Spicy, well, how many think you could take and what would you use?
No, I mean, that's. I just said it. Like, I'd do, like, an intermediate cartridge rifle. Like,
but how many would you kill, you think, of the four that are hunting you?
Well, that's what I just said. I said I'd probably kill one.
One? Okay, I'm sorry, I missed that.
Like, I mean, I'd probably kill one. And you might, at that point, you'd probably be able, with some automatic rifle, to wound one or two more. But maybe not likely kill them. And at that point, I mean, they close that distance. You're done.
Gooch, what you doing?
I'm in the same boat. Probably kill one.
Three quarter staff.
Yeah, if I use like a 7.62 or a 3.08, probably okay. Kill one, wound one or two more. I mean, it's a lot with four of those coming at you. That's a lot to think about, you know?
Here's another thing. Are they all coming at you in the same direction, or are they fighting together and coming multiple directions?
Multiple directions.
They would likely come at you in a line. They would likely come at you in a line from one direction, but then as they get closer,
they fan out.
They're going to break off, and they're going to start flanking.
So my plan would be something along the lines of, again, I like the idea of having some sort of physical protection, some full armor, mostly steel, light, either made out of titanium and some heavy padding underneath. So you're ready to take some concussive blows, as well as it's relatively light, like some Buhurt kit, which is massively padded. Large shield. And then I've given this just too much thought, unfortunately. A cutout in this tower shield where you would lock in some sort of heavy gun or rifle that you could, it's a semi-automatic or fully automatic rifle. You hook into kind of a, I don't know if you guys have ever seen them. I think there's some modern bulletproof shields that do this. There's a cutout where you kind of lock your rifle in. It goes back to like I forgot what type of people use them a lot, but it was a tower shield, had a kind of a groove cut out of it so you could stick a spear in it. But instead of a spear, I'm talking a rifle. So I would lock up, set that tower shield down, lock a rifle into it, and then have a somewhat dug in position, like find an area where there was like some kind of maybe mushy ground that might slow them down as they're approaching. I think I could take two in that situation before I went down. Like, especially considering that how Buhurt armor is set up, like modern sport kits, like you can build for some massive concussive blows. And even if their talons are razor sharp, they're not going through any kind of titanium unless they catch you in a really, really weak spot, like under the arm and the groin, like in the ass. Like if they're going for an ass shot, you're fucked. But I think I could take out two with some sort of like heavy tower shield set up with some Buhurt armor and a fully automatic weapon for sure, easily. But I'd get torn apart after that.
I think something that's important to consider with this too is we don't really know how thick the hide is on them, and it's a leathery type skin. So I mean, if you've got a really thick leathery type hide, that is going to offer some form of ballistic protection, at least with smaller cartridges.
And that's why I wouldn't go for any kind of melee weapon against these things. I believe that as they're scaling up here, we're talking about some thick ass
these aren't ballistic tested for dinosaurs.
Obviously,
I know the like Kevlar rating, but I don't know what dinosaur hide rating comes down to.
I would think so. To my knowledge, the way leather armor works, and the way I have used a lot of leather, like to build armor, and I think that the hide that these things have is probably akin to like that of like a buffalo or something like that. So you're talking about a hide that naturally will basically eat an arrow and tell you to fuck off. So if you're looking at something like that, like what would it take to kill a buffalo, but like on a creature that's super, super fucking fast and hard to hit? That's just my guess if I had to like.
So if you're using an ammo round, would you want something that's light and fast or heavy and slow?
Heavy and slow.
Question.
Heavy and slow.
Well, like an incendiary round.
Wouldn't you want something fast to penetrate any kind of. You want heavy and slow to just do maximum damage?
To do more damage. Yeah.
Yep. So the problem is with ballistics is that, so a lot of times your high velocity rounds, so sidebar, I know this is a dinosaur thing, but so a 5.56 round is considered a high velocity round, the NATO round. It shoots super fast. And so one of the things that is needed to penetrate steel armor is high velocity. So it's not a very big round, but it'll just pierce right through it because it's going so fast. The problem is when it hits something that has a little bit of resistance, sometimes it's not a big enough round to have enough mass behind it, because the mass times velocity being the force of a round. So you have the velocity there, but you don't have the mass behind it to really impact the force.
And you're also talking about this creature who that shot, if it did penetrate, how much damage would it really do to it?
Well, and even a large, like big and slow round is not slow. It's just slower by ballistic standards. It's still cooking along at like over 1,200 feet per second.
You can't afford a miss. That's a thing.
That's why I think that we all had the right idea with a lot of rounds head the same direction because of how fast these things are.
like I said, I'd be relying mostly on fear. Like if I were to take a rifle, I'd want an underbarrel flamethrower like they sell online now.
Like
just because you need buddy. Fire. You need fire.
The only problem with flamethrowers though is that they last for a very short time.
You know what? If I burn its face and it decides to run away, it served its purpose.
I think it's the only one that lives to fight another day. The rest of us would go down fucking slaying. Fuck it.
I think I've come to the realization that the best weapon against these creatures is a sacrifice.
It's a just be faster than the people next to you.
Just stack a bunch of claymores on you and just like let them come at you.
You just have to be faster than the person next to me.
Yeah,
that's all it is. I don't even have to fire around. I'll just be faster than anybody else, and then I'll be fine. Okay.
Does anyone think they could take on an Allosaurus?
That is a hard sell.
I would say no.
No.
I mean, at that point, you're talking about an entrenched.
You'd have to have a 50 cal. You'd have to have know where it's coming from, and you'd have to be sitting somewhere waiting for it.
You'd have to have a defensible position, like.
Yeah, like essentially.
In the trees, firing from the ground.
For our audience, let's describe this creature. For those who don't know an Allosaurus.
It's like a small T-Rex.
It's a small T-Rex, yes. So it's about twice the height of a human being. It is very long. Think about like a school bus.
Like 7 meters for sure.
Yeah.
If not more.
This thing's like.
Yeah, length 7.5 to 10.5 meters.
Mm-hmm. 25 to 30 feet for us Americans.
Hey, it lived in North America. Look at that.
Yeah. It's basically, I believe this one was known to be a scavenger, but like I said, if we're dealing with a fight, it doesn't really matter.
If it is a thing that wants to kill you, I believe this would have no issues killing. Like,
problem is, this thing is a single person. A smaller T-Rex with appropriately sized arms.
Right. Yeah. This one actually has arms. Yeah. thing is terrifying.
That's why it's the Allosaurus. It's got all of it.
Oh, yes. God, I hate it.
So, you know, Marlin, a firearm manufacturer, claims, because this is what Chris Pratt carried in Jurassic World, claiming that the 4570
can kill a T-Rex, apparently.
Oh, shit, dude. Have you ever
fire it at a T-Rex.
Yeah, 4570 is not as big as people think it is.
I'd love to see a test where ballistics tests are done against just the skull of a T-Rex, where you maybe it's out there. Who knows? I probably am going to prove wrong immediately. But like the thickness of the skull and the bone on some of these creatures, like we're talking about piercing hide, but then we're also talking about piercing these fucking massive skulls. Like if you're going to go for a headshot or something like that, I'm assuming an organ shot might be more.
You don't go for a headshot on a T-Rex because the brain is so small. Like
exactly, where are you going to hit? You're not going to mess it up at all, right?
Well, and it's like any hunting concept. You're not going to go for a bone that is going to have a chance to reflect the bullet or deflect it.
Well, even an organ shot, I feel like you're still going to, like, the bullet is going to be so small. How much damage is it going to do to this size creature?
This thing is pure muscle. It's just muscle with some hide around it. That's all it is. Like.
Bullet.
Yeah, so there's a 50 BMG, the number 6.
Jesus.
And that's five seven T-Rex.
Mm-hmm.
So, honestly. In my opinion, with something like an Allosaurus, now that we're getting into this classification of dinosaur, unless you are in an entrenched and elevated position with a clear sight line with like a bolt action like elephant gun, you are not taking that thing down.
So what about near future technology, like some sort of mech suit?
I think
that's a thing that could probably work that out.
What do you define as near future? Because I think we're still a ways off from that.
Are you using like the sound frequencies?
Ooh, there you go. We're thinking.
Could that have an effect?
What about an explosive crossbow bolt, my guys? If we're gonna talk seriously, let's talk about Rain of Fire and how they literally killed the dragon by shooting it with an explosive crossbow bolt.
I was going to say, like, a crossbow bolt that explodes, though, isn't really, like, new technology.
Right. So, with that type of dinosaur, with a good shot from an explosive crossbow bolt, which could conceivably be carried very easily, and crossbows are insanely easy weapons to use, I think it could be done with an explosive crossbow tip.
So, yes, but I mean, either you're going to make it angry, you're going to miss, or you're just going to piss it off. And if you piss it off, you're done for.
If you piss it off, or what if you scare it, like you were saying, Raj? Like, how often does that kind of, that just the noise, the flame, all that kind of stuff happen in that creature's world? Never. So I think that you could at least scare it off, and or let's just say you get the perfect shot and shoot it straight in the mouth. Boom, you're blowing up its fucking head.
So my whole thing about the mech suit is, so an Allosaurus has a bright force about 3,500 newtons, which is on par with like wolves in terms of bite force.
That's it?
Yeah. But it's 10 times the size.
Dude, if it's got the bite force of a wolf, you could wear that's easy to get against. You might get shook and shaken around a bit and like your limbs would fucking break. But like, dude, you could wear any kind of armor that's like in the vicinity of like 60 to 80 pounds medieval armor, and that
you don't think it would crush the armor into your body?
Absolutely not. Not a wolf bite. Wolf bite would do absolutely shit. This is a wolf bite. To a 16th century plate armor.
It's a wolf bite, but with a mouth 10 times the size.
Sure, but if it generates the same force, it's not doing shit to you. It's not actually going to crush your armor.
There's more mass though.
Here's where I'm going to say that that's going to be a little bit different playing out. The teeth are going to be longer, bigger, more pointed, and so that's gonna, you're gonna have a higher level of force and pressure on that pinpoint. So one, it's going to pierce some of that armor, or it's going to get around where there's gaps in the armor.
100%, yeah, I agree.
The other issue is you're gonna die from internal crush injuries at the very least.
You're gonna stick a tree between its jaws.
I just think that if it had a higher PSI, I do believe it would do more damage. But like, if it's only got the PSI of a wolf bite, I don't think that it would be, I mean, not once you're in his jaws, you're fucking done anyway, but I don't think it would do more damage, enough damage to the armor. I think it'd be the being lifted and if it shakes you or digs at you, like it'd be the force pulling you apart. I think the armor would do its job, but I think that like your hip would dislocate, your shoulder would dislocate, you'd snap your neck first. You wouldn't die of
pieces
crushing,
of armor.
You'd die of, your armor might be okay, but you'd fucking get ripped apart.
Your armor is held around by leather straps, right?
Depending.
Yeah. So if it gets its claws into any of those crevices and pulls, it's ripping that leather and
off. That's a million-dollar shot on a piece of armor, I'm not gonna lie.
You don't think it's gonna hold you down and start scratching at you until it gets something?
That's what I'm saying. I think that it would pull on the armor, but it would rip your limb off before the armor got damaged. I honestly think what would happen is the armor would be mostly fine with some dents and scratches, but you would have a leg over there, your head would be tossed 15 feet and it'd be ripping at your organs, and the arm would be okay. You'd just be like, you'd be cracked open like a fucking clam.
Oh,
that's all I'm saying. Like the armor would get pulled apart, but the armor itself would be fine. You'd get fucked up.
This is the scary part. So now that we know how much force an Allosaurus has, how much do you think a alligator has?
Ooh, I don't know.
A lot.
Oh, I'd fuck up an alligator though. Fuck alligators. I would beat the shit out of an alligator. I've given that a lot of thought.
So just if you guys want to put your guesses out there, no searching, just guess.
I'm pretty sure I remember it's like 1,200 pounds.
Is everyone agreeing that?
Yeah, that's pretty close.
I don't have a guess.
13,000.
Yeah.
Oh!
13,000.
Well, that's...
It is only 400 newtons less than a Tyrannosaurus Rex.
All right, Raj, say it misses its first bite and you sit on its face. What happens then?
Yeah, then it can't open its mouth. You got us there. Because they can't, their opening force is way less than their closing force.
I beat an alligator any day of the week. You've got alligator wrestlers that do it with no armor. Give me some armor and a good warhammer. I'm killing an alligator. Easy.
Here's the thing, though.
Okay,
yeah, sure,
Steve Irwin.
But you're basically hoping that you get that first ability to get on top of it
100%.
And you do it correctly.
I'm like 90% sure that I could do that.
Can you guys
see a lot of people
now?
Say that. Yeah.
Listen to the Utah Raptor and imagine this shit.
Is that noise that we can hear on the podcast, by the way?
Can you not hear it?
Oh, I can hear it, but is that noise that's like being captured?
They'll hear it.
Oh my fucking god.
No,
this is what they with
no, no, no.
It's
nah.
How they talk to each other.
All right, nah, I'd run. Sorry, yeah. I'd run. I officially literally could fight zero of those things. That's fucking terrifying.
Well, so I don't know if you guys were paying attention when Mike was pulling this up, but it said that actually this project has been ongoing for 4 years, that they're trying to recreate accurately the sounds that they suspect that these dinosaurs would have made, because most didn't actually have the ability to do the singing quote like in the Jurassic Park 3 movie, mm-hmm. where he blew
not like the
gross. That's nightmare fuel.
Just imagine walking through the woods.
It's full on,
dude. That's the sound you hear before the aliens attack.
Yeah,
that reminds me a lot of what's that movie we just went and saw, Gooch? This has a lot of that same sound quality that Nope had. Absolutely.
In the woods, in the middle of the night.
No.
If that was what was serenading me at night, I get kind of jibbed out when I hear coyotes freaking out, dude.
Yeah, man.
Dude, it freaked me out when I heard an elk call.
Yeah, dying coyote was in the middle of the woods. Yeah. That's like, it sounds like a zombie eating something.
Because they were saying basically what we see in the movies where they can like sing to each other and intelligently communicate, that's not actually ever been proven.
Oh, shit.
Dude, imagine hearing noises. That at night. Oh.
A Mosasaurus?
Dude, you would feel that in the boat, bro.
Oh, for those that are
right before the whole boat got eaten in one.
This
bite.
Is the dinosaur in Jurassic Park, the new movie, the one inside the aquarium.
Fuck that. I hate this. These underwater. Mm.
Oh,
the Quetzalcoatlus. Do you guys know what the wingspan on that? They just discovered that recently. It's the largest jet.
It's a jet fighter.
It's larger than a jet. That was a very recent thing that they were like, hey, this is like now the newest, largest flying creature that we've ever discovered. That was a relatively recent discovery. I forgot what the wingspan is, but it compared it to a jet, like a modern jet. It is much larger.
So would somebody just listen to this to fall asleep? Like 3 hours of dinosaur ambience.
God damn it. Okay, so who agrees that there needs to be a new set of modern dinosaur movies? Jurassic Park has like the sole idea. They're like, they have the same idea they've been running with for a long time. I think that there needs to be a new like horror movie dinosaur.
They make them on sci-fi all the time.
No, not those, Raj. Not Raptor Jesus or whatever the hell that one is.
Well, they can't think of any other way to introduce dinosaurs to this time period. Like,
imagine it being done at like in a AAA quality, or sorry, like a large movie franchise being done with like all the shit that we know about dinosaurs now, like, and not Jurassic Park.
You mean like Jurassic World?
No.
But here's the thing. Jurassic Park has set the precedent on what dinosaurs act and look like to most people that are not like looking up this stuff. So for them, it's just like, this is what Jurassic Park is. If anything else comes out that doesn't look like or feel like Jurassic Park, it just doesn't get.
It would be. I'm not saying that it would do well. I'm saying it would be ballsy, but like imagine a horror movie set along some of these creatures and some of those noises. Like,
They try with the Megalodon. They try Lake Placid.
No, Megalodon was
good.
Lake Placid was okay. Megalodon was terrible.
Just because
absolutely terrible. But for some people who like don't like water, and also top 10 fears, Megalodon.
It was
like,
basically Chinese propaganda for like most of the movie.
Yeah,
it's just like paid for by Chinese government. Here you go.
So we kind of brought it up earlier. One that I wanted to bring up is that Quetzalcoatlus. That is actually a really interesting bird. So, side note, first time I ever heard about this thing was in a Dungeons & Dragons game because it appears in actually the Tomb of Annihilation. It doesn't. I think what it is there's a supplemental book that basically included the creature. Mm-hmm. This is a bird that has a huge wingspan that literally stands on the tips of its wings. This thing is the size of a giraffe.
Dude, it looks like a stork, doesn't it?
Kind
of,
yeah.
That is what brings the babies. Look at it. It's the bringer of babies.
The bringer of children.
Yeah, so that's a good point. I don't know if you guys know the origin of the name is actually Quetzalcoatl.
Isn't it like Aztec?
So it, yes and no. So the Quetzalcoatl, so they are the feathered serpent god in mythology of Mesoamerica. So basically it's the god of the winds and rain, creator of the world and humanity, blah, 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 and all of their beliefs. The Aztecs know this entity as Quetzalcoatl. The Maya, the Yucatec Maya, know it as Kukulcan.
Kukulcan.
Dang.
So it's in the depictions when you look into like mythology for like Aztec Maya or any kind of the like North, Central, and Southern American like religion, like mythology.
Behind that name,
it's the common feathered serpent that you see.
What the hell is that last thing? it looks stupid.
Right now, there's a YouTube video going of size comparisons to a human. Creatures. Oh, look at the Pokemans.
Dude, that giant moray, dude, that is my nightmares to run into in the ocean.
That. Yep. Oh, that's why that is the simple reason to not go into the ocean. Yeah, I was gonna say you wanna talk about the scariest thing you can possibly do to yourself is go into the ocean, because we don't know we know more about space than we do about the fucking ocean. And it's on our goddamn planet.
Gooch, do you know that early shark that literally looked like it had a buzzsaw for teeth?
Yes.
Yep. Oh my god, that thing is
don't
terrifying.
Talk about it. I'm literally gonna log on. You guys start talking about sharks. I'm gonna log right off this.
So you look do not like thing. Shark Week.
I've never once watched Shark Week. I do not claim to fear many things, but I fear the ocean. I fear what in the hell is that? No, so, I fear creatures in the ocean because they like it's literally home to you can be walking along a beach and get poked by something and it'll kill you. Like there's a chance that when you take a step on a beach, like, oh, there's a jellyfish that washed up on shore and like, oh, you're fucking poisoned or some shit. Like that shit happens. Or like those like bobbit worms. I know those are way, way deep in the ocean. You ever seen a bobbit worm?
Yeah.
Yep.
Those are literally nightmare fuel. They like will pop out, will fucking snag you. They'll do all sorts of shit. Like, and they're really deep in the ocean again. So, not something you have to be concerned about on the beach, but still.
So, yeah, and like in sheer size, though. Like, I think for me, what really gets it is just being in the middle of the ocean and just seeing a pair of teeth coming at you that are like the size, like incomprehensible.
All it takes
size,
is the right set of circumstances for a shark to decide to fuck you up. While it happens less, it's a perfect storm situation. But being ripped apart by a prehistoric creature in the ocean where you have less of a chance of defending yourself, like, entirely, like, absolutely not. Absolute nightmare fuel.
See, I always had a, like, I know that sperm whales don't attack people, but I just have
what if they decided to hit you really hard because they were swimming by and didn't see you? You would die.
Yeah, you just die. You just instantly
die. Or killer whales?
Let's killer whales will play with you before they kill you.
Killer whales would, you'd fucking, I mean, shit.
To torture their prey before they kill it. Like
dolphins,
like mess with
imagine
it.
Dolphins were having a bad day. Dolphins would fuck you up. Dolphins could fuck you up. Everyone's like, "Oh, dolphins, sweet." Like, no, if dolphins had a real bad day, they could kill you,
bro.
They kill sharks for fun. Oh, they don't just kill them. They kill them for fun because they decide they can do it and they have enjoyment out of it.
There was a prehistoric whale that used to hunt megalodons, where they were like right up there where they would hunt each other. It was like.
Yeah,
it was the scariest looking, like, prehistoric whale were, like, actually predatory for the most part. Like,
I believe that, 100%. But what else?
Oh, that's the one. That's the one right there, the black and white with the teeth.
Oh, no.
He used to hunt sharks and other whales,
dude. This is what's crazy about the Cambrian period, dude. Everything was just out to kill everything else.
Survival of the fittest, dude.
It wasn't even survival of the fittest. It was like, who can have the biggest, baddest teeth? Who can have the meanest, nastiest poison? Who can have the biggest, strongest armor? I mean,
it was a science experiment. It was nature's science experiment where they were basically like, let's make all these messed up creatures and let them duke it out and see.
And let them evolve to the point where they are killing machines.
It was literally
terrifying.
So
I hate this
bone-headed fish.
I hate this. Oh my god!
Skull was just bone, bro.
I'm not gonna sleep tonight.
And they
imagine that. Look at the teeth. That just looks violent.
Oh yeah, it could just chop through whatever it wants.
What that reminds me of? You know the parrotfish that has teeth like that?
Yep.
In Amazon, they've become carnivorous now. There used to be only eat like fruits and things that have fallen into the water. In the Amazon, they've now turned carnivorous and they're calling them ball cutters now. Because they're known to, if you're bathing in the Amazon and your man bits are dangling around, it'll come and just slice it open.
No thanks.
Fun facts with Raj.
Absolutely not. Sounds,
this entire period in history like a nope is literally like just inviting 1,000 chainsaw jugglers to a game of catch.
Yeah.
It's basically what it is, isn't it? It's basically who's going to eat who and who's going to survive.
Hate it.
Oh, I don't know why you even try to compare the Megalodon to that thing. Megalodon is like 5 times the size. Like, there's no comparison. Like maybe
Cambrian was like the epitome of there's always a bigger fish, man.
Oh, don't with the animations. Don't with the...
Oh, God, dude.
It's the goofiest, scariest looking fucking thing I've ever seen.
Oh, my God.
Like, huh, yuck, but it'll bite you in half.
Oh, that thing looks like an Elden Ring boss.
It's like giving a hillbilly a fucking bazooka.
If you saw that in the water, dude, run. Run as fast. Oh, my God.
No,
and they're hunting packs? They're hunting packs?
No, I firmly believe
that
with the amount of the ocean that is still unexplored.
That's what it is. The next one there, Mike.
There's some dumb shit
down
there.
Leviathan versus Megalodon. Oh, my God.
Stop it.
Dude.
That's messed up, bro.
Oh, God. It just permanently has an evil grin on it.
God, yep. Gotta drink more. Why are we doing this? I'm just gonna minimize this. I'm not looking at any of this anymore. I'm good.
Right, so for the viewers, we're now watching a giant whale versus a megalodon animation.
God, please join us. Also, feel free to troll Chris on his fear of the deep water.
You guys don't. I know you guys get it, but like, it's just so concerning. It's just so massively concerning that like we something on our own planet we know less about than space.
Did you see that?
Yeah.
It's chasing it.
Oh my fuck. I reopened it. What the fuck? Oh my God.
It's basically a sperm whale just like mutated.
That hunted sharks.
It hunted megalodons for God.
Oh no.
When they talk about a leviathan in the water, this is what they mean. Like, this is pure terror.
Nope.
Run, sharks, run, run.
Speaking of that, so that shot, you know that shot where it's, so there's an actual fear. There's an actual name for that. I forgot what it is, where there is a big, dark, open space, and then you're kind of spatially unaware, and then something large approaches. It was talked about. Yeah, has anyone seen that new Netflix movie where there's like the giant? It's like red. I think it's called Red. I'm not sure.
No, I haven't seen it.
One sec. I'm gonna double check my shit here. It's a movie about a pirate crew that comes into contact with. Let me see. Disney movie or not Disney?
Oh God.
Let's see. It's called The Sea Beast is what it's called. So The Sea Beast is there's a concept that they use. While it's a pretty cute adorable movie, it's very good. I loved it. It's the concept that the depth hides massive things. So like you can be swimming in open water and it's where your sight's limited, and just beyond that sight there's something lurking. And that's literally the whole idea.
Well, and that's the thing. There's an actual phobia of deep waters.
Oh, sure.
Like,
but no, it's the top picture there. Gooch, if you go to that top, very top, very top, next one up. That right there. So there's a point. If you watch this scene, this is the scene that like is terrifying people. It's this. It's that space, and then whenever it'll move away and it disappears, but it's still so close to them. This right here. That exact thing right there is what's terrifying. It's a name. I'm sure that someone probably is like, oh, that's the phobia called blank. But no, that's a fucking thing that is.
Well, first off, it would never just move away like this. It would just end your life and be over with. Like,
sure. Yeah, totally.
There's no getting away from that.
Why are we?
Thalassophobia.
There you go. That's why I don't know. Yeah. Yep. Yep.
Fear of disappearing in water.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah. So the Leviathan was the same size as a sperm whale, like a full grown adult sperm whale, just with bigger teeth.
Oh yeah. This one rocks.
I've seen that.
The goldfish.
This is specifically thalassophobia animations. Like, literally animations to trigger a fear of deep water.
I'm happy that I'm just taking another drink, buddy. Fuck it.
Look at that cute little fish swimming around, having a good time. Having a whole fuck.
Oh my God! Oh, sorry that I yelled.
These things scare me more than most. Like Jesus, the angler fish.
Oh my God. No! No! No!
Chris, watch this in VR.
Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. No, no, no.
Face
no,
your
no,
fear.
No, 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 no. No, 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 no.
That's an eye!
No!
No, that's a little light dangling, isn't it?
Oh my God, that's an eye.
Oh yeah, pools.
That was cool.
It's the fucking. This is the worst. This is the worst. Why did I? I could have just kept eating my sandwich and not joined you guys for this. Oh my God.
Oh, look, it's Subnautica.
Subnautica. Yeah.
Yes.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, Subnautica. By the way, it looks like a cool game, and I like was tempted to be like, yeah, sure, I'll play that. And I was like, no, I can't.
You would not survive.
I would never survive
that. It is amazing how playing a game like that for even just sitting on a couch still instills some of that same fear.
It's just that it's that unknown space. Oh my Lord. I'd still hate it. Chris. I still hate it with every part of my being.
That would just be a rough spot to be in anyway.
Is that real? Is that real footage? That's not real, right? That's not real.
No, I'm promising.
Oh my God! All right.
Chris is never coming back to the podcast. Yeah. He's done. This is how we're gonna start every podcast from now on. Just deep sea videos. Oh, that's Cthulhu.
Oh, I hate this.
Oddly enough, the least terrifying of them all.
Yeah, this one ain't so bad.
He's, at least he just puts you to sleep.
Look at how cute the impending doom is. I went deep sea fishing one time, and it was in South Carolina with this dude named Captain Wally.
Yeah,
and he was the captain of the Sea Wolf 3. Is anyone would anyone be concerned with a name like the Sea Wolf 3?
Yeah.
No.
All right. Right.
What happened
I was
first
like,
two?
Exactly. So I was like sitting there. Being like terrified as shit of deep water anyway, and we kind of got out their ways, and I was trying to be cool and be chill. I was a bit younger, and I was like, hey, Captain Wally, and he's like sitting there doing his captain's like thing. He's just a small deep sea fishing boat. It's like, what happened to the Sea Wolf 1 and 2? And he goes, we don't talk about the Sea Wolf 1 and 2. And I about shit my pants. What do you mean we don't talk about the Sea Wolf 1 and 2? What happened to them? And he never said anything else.
I'd love to talk about it.
Yeah, like I'd love to hear. Like, did they just retire? Did they get old? Like, did they get sunk or whatever? I don't know.
They got old, Chris.
I guess
they went to the scrapyard.
It might have. That's probably what happened. But he just said, "We don't talk about the Sea Wolf 1 and 2." Like, all right, you creepy old man.
We were talking about fishing in the Cambrian period.
Oh, I'm sure that would be neat. Never do it.
Interesting. Yeah, I was about to say you would never do that.
Absolutely not.
This is not way.
Would not be
now,
good at
now,
all.
Now, do you guys believe that we should be able to bring these animals back?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Like the ethical side of that, or like
ethical,
the actual
environmental
ability?
Like the environmental, the toll.
I'm a big fan of anything that poses a danger to humans, because it means that the population would be thinned out to a degree, which means that the world might survive longer.
Well, my thing is, like, I would say it's probably bad business to bring something back that is at a higher level of the food chain than you.
Mm-hmm. Oh, totally.
Is it, though? Would it be? Because technically lions are deadly to us, but we still are the top of the food chain.
Like a lion will fuck up like five grown men, no problem.
The thing is, because like,
we're smarter and we have weapons.
We have literally like five movies of why we should not do this.
I know. I would love to see it. I think that it'd be a great. Whenever you're talking about overpopulation, like what about it?
You're acting like the governments wouldn't just decide to nuke that entire island if something like that would. Happened. Yeah, like it would be over for the dinosaurs the moment something went wrong. So,
yep.
The big thing is like I could see like just some unplanned circumstance happening, just like what happens in those movies, to where there's something that happens that allows these to escape into a wilderness setting.
Mm-hmm. I believe that we should not bring animals back that died due to natural selection, but we should bring the ones that are brought that are already on the verge of extinction or extinct because of human hunting or human influence on the planet.
Well, and honestly, that's just an argument for conservation efforts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we could do an entire episode on animals that are now extinct because of humans and if we should or shouldn't bring them back.
And also, life finds a way.
Here's the thing, woolly mammoths were technically endangered because of the amount they were hunted, too.
Yeah, but would a woolly mammoth really thrive in this environment now?
In the Arctic?
No. Not with the current, not with...
The Arctic, what's it going to eat in the Arctic?
Yeah, because it'd be more in the Serbia area, wouldn't it? Because woolly mammoths were in the ice. They were ice age animals, so they did survive.
Yeah, but they still need food.
But what would they do for food at that point?
Interesting.
Well, they probably ate like a shit ton of moss.
Just moss.
Probably. Lichens. Honestly. Moss. Motherfucking tree stars. They ate motherfucking tree stars where they could find them.
Tree stars.
So, has anyone talked about Land Before Time since you guys have been doing this podcast? Yeah, I'm sore.
Okay. I don't want to cry.
Briefly mentioned. Okay, I was gonna say I would be so disappointed in all of you as individuals if it wasn't mentioned one time before I got here. Like Land Before Time is like oof.
I brought it up in Littlefoot.
There was also an old dinosaur movie. I think it was just called Dinosaurs. I don't know if you remember that one.
Are you talking about like the hyper realistic one? Yeah,
the one with like the Carnotaur and everything on it.
Yep, that was a Disney film. I remember
that. That was a pretty decent movie, actually. Also, does anyone remember We're Back? Does anyone at all know the movie called We're Back?
Yep.
Raise your hand. Timmy, are you Timmy? You've heard of it?
I don't know.
Here it is, right here, Dinosaur.
Yep, there's that one, yep. Oh yeah, my god, that was a cute movie. Yeah, it was also super fucking sad whenever all the things happened. Except for
that's in a foreign language, so it's like Dinosaurier.
No, we're back. Yes! I was obsessed with this movie as a kid. Also, John Goodman. Let's go.
Yeah, it was good. It was a good movie.
We're Back was awesome, man.
I loved We're Back. The concept was super neat.
This is the same era that I loved watching movies Steven like All Spielberg. Dogs Go to Heaven.
Yeah, who all was in that? Can we get a cast? Is this
like the same time as like the Aristocrats and stuff?
I believe
no. No, later. I believe it was later. Way earlier.
Yeah, it's way later. What's the cast? Let's see who was in We're Back as voices. 6 out of 10. Fuck you. This movie's amazing.
How dare you,
John Goodman, Charles Fleischer. Oh my,
Jay Leno.
Perlman? Jay Leno was in this. Oh, of course he was. Yeah. Oh yeah, I think Jay Leno was in it as himself.
Actually. Walter Cronkite.
Oh, what in the heck, Walter Cronkite?
Julia Child.
Martin Short.
Wait, the French. What? Like the lady who made her claim to fame by doing French cooking, Julia Child, was in this movie.
Yeah, she was Dr. Bleeb. What?
Oh, Fern Gully. That was my stuff, man.
Yeah, Fern Gully was the shit. But yeah. Oof, this movie had some good feels too.
Now that we've spiraled from dinosaurs into dinosaur movies.
Oh,
God, that's
long. Yeah.
I think it needs to be remastered.
100%. To the circus.
Oh, man. We'll be back here.
God.
He sent them some help.
They want to meet you. What do you say?
Creepy old man says I want to meet you to a random kid.
Farewell, my friend. Just try not to step on anybody.
You gotta be kidding. Welcome to New York City.
Who are you guys anyway? Dinosaurs, actually.
What the heck?
Such strange American animation style back then, man.
Yes, it was.
It was like a quarter weeb and then like three quarters like practical.
Well, did you ever watch the shows like Five Goes West or something?
Oh, yes.
Like that?
Five Goes West was insanely good.
Yeah.
You guys ever remember watching a show where they used to take like these prehistoric animals, bring them back in CG and make them fight?
Yes. What was that called? Oh, I watched that show religiously.
Dude, the megalodon versus the ancient saltwater shark or all saltwater gator. I forget the. They had all kinds of ones. They had like bear versus gorilla. Like,
Well, since you guys are talking about prehistoric creatures, has anyone talked about like the more recent? I forgot what the most recent era was called, but like where we had like those really large bears that were like 8 feet tall, and the saber-toothed tigers. Yeah, the ones that were like North American located, like the one like there was a skull of this thing found like in like Michigan or like
last episode we talked about the giant sloth that used to be in North America.
Yep,
the one that they think is most likely what the Bigfoot would be, like the giant crazy
animals.
No, that's Deadliest Warrior.
Deadliest Warrior was also
amazing. Was it Primeval?
It might be. No.
I think it's Animal Face Off.
It was
Animal Face Off. They must have
it must have been when they got started getting desperate. Saltwater, yeah.
That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
This must have been it. If you go down where they like ran out of things to fight each other, I think that they
Yeah, Solar Crocodile versus Great White Shark.
Yeah, okay. Maybe it wasn't like an ancient version. Maybe it was just I just remember the show very fondly. Like I remember watching like the craziest fights. No, there was one where it was like Titanoboa versus
might have been an offshoot of that.
Have you guys seen the dinosaur show where the guy goes back in time to collect them for a zoo?
I did not.
No.
You never saw that one?
No.
Oh, now I gotta find it.
I mean, I want to watch that.
Now, while Mike is looking that up, I am going to show one of my favorite prehistoric mammals. I'm going to share my screen. Oh, nope, I can't.
Now you can.
Copy that. Thank you.
You've been granted access.
Share your screen with us. Show us.
It's still saying it's disabled.
Hold on. Do 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 do. Stand by, friends. We are going to. One participant can show at a time. All participants. There you go, buddy.
Thank you. Let's see. So, can y'all see this?
Oh, it's adorable.
It is known as the jugulator.
Oh my God! Is it what is it? Did it eat other mammals?
The jugulator is also an album by Judas Priest.
Oh my!
Making
it a contemporary of the Spinosaurus.
Well, so it lived during the Cretaceous period. One of the largest carnivorous dinosaurs ever lived was the Spinosaurus. The agile jugulator, experienced tree climber glider. Despite weighing 750 grams, one of the largest mammals of its time, and lived in what is now Northwest America, it vaguely resembled a squirrel, but it belonged to the order of Utricondants, which disappeared 70 million years ago.
Oh my God! It's a massive squirrel. It's a massive flying squirrel. It's like if a sugar glider took steroids and decided one night it might bite your jugular out.
I just love the fact that there is a like prehistoric large squirrel known as a jugulator.
Jesus, that's so funny. It's actually it's adorable, but like kind of a scary way.
that one's a
special creature.
I found it.
Oh, you found it?
What is it?
I can't believe I found it. It's called Prehistoric Park.
Prehistoric Park. Wait a second. Why does that sound familiar now?
Dude. Hold on, let's make sure we can all hear it.
So these are all North American animals, guys, that you're looking at. Look at the size of this bear sloth thing. It is standing up as tall as the elephant is. Okay. There was a camel in North America.
Oh my God.
What?
The giant prehistoric millipede? No thanks.
I hate that.
hit every bit of that.
Oh God.
So 2006 Prehistoric Park.
Prehistoric Park. I'm telling all of our viewers to watch this show. It's amazing. So this guy is, his goal is to go back in time and create a theme park where he's conserving these,
a theme park with dinosaurs. Never been done before. That's fucking wild.
But so he actually goes back and he catches them without hurting them.
So it's like Jurassic Park if he worked for the DNR. Remember we saw the tracks of this prey. That rearing
up is obviously a defensive reaction. It's knockoff Steve Irwin.
I love this. They remember Jeff Corwin?
Yeah.
Dude was okay, but Steve Irwin. They've only seen the fossils.
Nobody's even pretty sure whether this is a predator. Okay, I gotta watch this show.
Yeah,
now.
I'm in on that. Speaking of another dinosaur movie, has anyone here heard of the movie called Prehysteria?
Yes. No.
Have you ever heard of the movie called Velocipaster?
Yes, Velocipaster. That's when I was, I don't know what I call Raptor Jesus's thing. So I started with Velocipaster was the one that I was thinking of.
You just look it up. Velocipaster.
10 out of 10.
I don't even know what to say to that.
This was a COVID movie that I watched that
I regret everything. I loved it. It was so good. But dude, Prehysteria.
Just look at the title picture of it.
It's
got a velociraptor, it's got a zombie priest, and it's got ninjas.
Yes, there are ninjas in Velocipaster. There are. Dude. Yes,
there should be.
Oh, Velocipaster. I have so many good memories about Velocipaster. Yep. Yep. So the main thing, it's not a giant spoiler, but the main dude turns into that, and there is literally a scene where he's in a dinosaur suit, which is like a man-sized dinosaur suit, and fights ninjas.
Losing his parents, a priest travels to China, where he inherits a mysterious ability that allows him to turn into a dinosaur.
Do you remember his dead parents?
Oh my god. Yeah.
At first horrified by the new power, a hooker convinces
him. This is what it shows. It's his VFX car on fire for his dead parents.
Okay, I've got to watch this.
It's mega self-aware, and I had a good time.
I'm going to have to watch this.
This is like a movie that kids would make for like their like theater or a movie club.
Yep.
Oh, here it is. Oh, I thought it was going
to
show a little
mom and dad. And then it cuts to that scene where it says VFX car on fire. Yep.
Also, one of the funniest like B-list, C-list horror movies that I've seen in a long time was when we got together and watched the movie Zombievers.
Zombievers, I enjoyed. I really like Zombievers. It has its merits. Look at that.
Mom and dad!
Yep. VVX car on fire.
No. Oh my god.
I recently watched a movie called Llamageddon.
Oh god.
Where it's an actual llama they just VFX red eyes onto and reacted to. The whole movie was them reacting to a llama doing normal llama things, but with red eyes CG'd onto it, and that's the only change.
Yeah, doesn't he like look inside while they're in the hot tub or something, and they're like freaking out?
Oh my god, yeah.
Oh god.
Yep.
Oh my god.
Yep, that's the whole movie. It's just a llama doing normal llama shit.
What does this podcast come to? What are we talking? What is happening?
Look at the llama arms. Oh, yep.
Taking a significant turn.
This has gone so wrong.
We have just basically like delved into like film project class.
The greatest movie in the world.
Got a Star Trek shirt on.
Yep.
So the people listening, please don't look this up.
Please oh, don't. I think that people must sanity. Watch these movies.
Like, no, not so... Zombieverse, please.
Zombieverse, ah, oh, so good. Great times. God. Only the best of times when I was watching Zombieverse.
Zombieverse Kill Count.
I remember the specific drink of that I was making while watching Zombieverse. It was my rum and rum, hard cider, and cider, and I had like six of them, and I was. To the absolute end of my rope on like how much I could drink. And I was like, Zombieverse, yes. I had a great time. I could not drink anymore, and I watched Zombieverse.
So you'll watch about zombies, but you won't watch about sharks?
Yeah. Absolutely. Sharks are the worst. Like, Jaws actually scared me a little bit.
Jaws scared everybody as a kid, dude. The Jumanji scared me as a kid. The giant plant thing that comes through the fireplace.
Jumanji kind of set the bar for kind of shit like that.
Yeah,
for like at least people in our generation, Jumanji was terrifying.
Oh, God. We have devolved quite a bit.
Yes.
Well, Velocipaster was at least on top.
Yeah, Velocipaster was on topic.
Right.
Thank you. Jeez.
The most important thing to keep in mind is the jugulator.
Man, we talked about killing dinosaurs if we could take them.
Should we bring them back?
Yeah, man. I mean,
should there be more dinosaur movies that aren't just Jurassic Park?
I think this is what our audience wants, though, man. Like, because here's the problem: we're ordinary people, right? This is our basis for this podcast, right? Mm-hmm. We're not experts in anything. I mean, maybe we went to school for stuff, but we're not like noticeably like
subject matter expert.
Yeah. Yes. So one of the things is, and this is where we were coming from when we started this, is we're tired of hearing these experts talk, but then you have to come up with your own conclusions in the end still. You know, they're supposed to be experts. I should feel like I 100% believe everything they say, and sometimes I just don't, you know?
Well, or they're really so careful. Dry. It's yeah, so dry the yeah. way they give information.
Or they're
so.
Really careful about how they say it. And they're like, well, we believe, right? Like,
yeah, if we get fact-checked, we're not going to shit our pants and be like, oh, right. Dang. Like, if someone was to be like, hey, what you said was wrong, we're not going to be like, well, I looked it up on said sort. We didn't. We didn't. Yeah. We're mostly, like, what we know is, like, whatever knowledge we have. Maybe read it somewhere. Maybe it's conjecture. Maybe it's just, like, life experience. But, like.
Oh, speaking of errors and being checked, I do want to redact something I said last podcast for the story that I gave about Vavilov, the gentleman who helped with World Seed Bank. That it was actually during the Battle of Leningrad, not Stalingrad.
Nice.
So there's a very minute issue,
yeah. But good job.
But I wanted to make sure that I put that out there so that it's, you know, I wanted to give them the correct. I mean, they're both vicious battles.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
During World War II, but one is Stalingrad and the other one was at Leningrad. So I just wanted to put that out there.
10-4.
Our buddy Nick is going to be very disappointed that it wasn't Stalingrad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I sold him on Stalingrad.
Oh, you got him going.
But yeah, like the whole goal is just get the veil off of our face. None of this crap. Let's just talk about real things, you know, come to our own conclusions, have fun with it. That's the whole point. And mm-hmm. I want everyone that's listening to feel like they're just hanging out with their friends. Really? Like, why can't you just sit in your car and feel like you're just hanging out with a bunch of chill bros that
are drunk as shit and you're the DD?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's
where
okay.
else are you going to learn
some
about
people
velocity?
Don't like that.
Yeah, there's not a lot of podcasts that would talk about Velocipaster. I'm sure there's like bad movie critics.
If you made that movie, please feel free to contact us. We'd love to have a podcast with you.
Yes, if there's a point where we get video, we should do like a MS3TK, like where all our silhouettes are there, watching Velocipaster.
Because I'm pretty sure that you're just an ordinary person as well who made a movie.
Pretty much.
I could probably confirm that. Like, that camera work, my guy.
The VFX was top notch. Your inflatable dinosaur costume was unbelievably good.
It was slightly better than what you can buy online, though.
Yeah.
It was higher than Halloween store grade.
Instead of 100, solid. It was 250. I'll give
some solid paper mache work.
Magnificent.
Paper mache.
Well, what do you think, guys?
I could talk about fighting dinosaurs for like
dinosaurs,
a whole
bro.
Day.
Well, what I would like to know, Chris, is where did this start?
What?
Where did this obsession start with fighting dinosaurs?
Well, my obsession start with, if I was going to at one day die, and I was like, I want to kind of like die in a cool way, right? It started with me fighting a bear in full armor, and what kind of bear would I fight, and how would I fight it? So it became like, would you fight a black bear? I was like, yeah, I could probably take a black bear in full armor, give him the right equipment and tools. And someone's like, well, what about a grizzly bear? And I was like, grizzly bear would probably fuck me up. Like, it would break me under my armor, and I would have internal bleeding, but my armor would probably be okay. And so that expanded into this idea of like, dude, well, what if I fought a velociraptor? You
know? You'd peel the lid like you were a can of tuna and just fucking
exactly. Like, I would, down. No, it wouldn't even need to do that. It would literally like swat me one time. My whole chest would cave in, but the armor would be fine.
The concussive
It started there. Like, it'd be me like, I'm at the end of my rope. I got nothing going for me. I'm like 48. Whatever, I'm gonna pay-per-view a fight with me and a grizzly bear in full armor and my family, whoever, all my friends get the donations. Everybody would buy a pay-per-view ticket to that. Everybody would be like, yeah, sure, I'll watch a dude fight a bear in a fucking in a cage.
Man fights bear, sure. Pay-per-view.
Yeah. Would you buy that for $2, Raj?
$2? You better charge more than $2
per person. Fight to the death, get it, yes, out there.
That, yeah, is minimum 20. Minimum 20 to watch.
Sure, why not? Make it more. But you would still buy that.
Yeah,
that's my point.
It's got to be at least 20, so the rest of us can split the profits for you.
It has to be a really mean bear though, because people don't like humans. So be like, oh, poor bear. Like, no, the bear would have had to have murdered.
No,
like,
it's got to be a polar bear, because then the bear has a vendetta against human
people
beings.
Like polar bears.
It has
a lot
to
these
be
days.
A grizzly.
Oh my god. Man, that's where that whole idea started. It's like, well, what if I fought a velociraptor? It's like, what would I do? Like that was a conversation I had internally for like a long
time. I believe you could fight everything up to a Utah raptor. After
yeah,
that,
I think that's our limitation. Like, anything that is approximately our size, outside of that, just the mass and size difference is just enough to be like, probably not. Even with firearms and whatever you could carry on your person, modern technology wise, it'd be difficult.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure there are people out there that think they can drunk fist fight a polar bear. I'm sure, they would love to try that, but I mean, for them, I'd just say natural selection.
Yep.
I mean, I had dreams for like a week in a row that I was fighting a bear every night that came into my backyard. Different bear. So
a different bear every time?
Yeah.
It's like, it was like Bear Fight Club, and they're like, no other bear talks about Fight Club, and they're like, no,
it's like Street
human.
Fighter
this
Tekken.
Brings it.
Well, because it was like, I got mad because they came into my fenced-in yard, so I went out and I fought the bear.
With your bare hands?
Yeah.
Bare hand bear boxing?
Yep.
Ever since I watched the video of the guy box that kangaroo for his dog, I've always wanted to try it.
There's like 1,000 of those videos, and that's just like an Australian's daily. Yeah. Like, they're trying to change their tire on their car, and a kangaroo comes up and is just a jackass, and they just fist fight it.
That's so crazy.
Like, that just happens.
But the sad thing is, it only takes one kick from a kangaroo to break your femur.
Oh yeah, but it takes a couple of good punches to tell a kangaroo to fuck off. That's for sure. They seem to get the point after a couple hits.
I couldn't believe that kangaroo was swole, like just in the gym 24/7, and it had that dog in a neck hold, dude.
Yeah.
He had full
rear
connection.
Naked,
he had arm
bro.
Over. And yep. The other arm connected, ready to choke this thing out. I was like, whoa. It's like, this dude went to Brazil.
Kangaroos are just transcended MMA fighters that have a small brain.
Bro, you see a male adult kangaroo stand up, and it's got big old beefy, it's got biceps, dude.
Mm-hmm.
It's got biceps, it got this big old barrel chest. It's looking a mess.
That's everything in Australia, though.
Yeah, that's true.
Everything's,
you wake up in Australia,
Australia.
And you think, God, yeah. That's the thing, though. You live in that kind of environment, like where I'm from, like, we don't need prehistoric animals to be afraid. We have plenty of stuff that'll kill us in our backyard. We just have to be careful. Dude, rogue elephants are a real problem in India. Like, if you live near tea plantations, apparently elephants love that kind of area. They love to eat, like, the tea leaves and stuff. They will jack you up.
Mm-hmm.
You don't even have to do anything. There's a case. It's so funny. I don't remember what country it was. I don't know if this was Africa or India, but I remember hearing the story where the elephants came to eat on a farmer's land, and the farmer, like, either he shot at them or like he like intimidated them or threw things at them. The elephants came back the next day and stomped his donkey to death.
What the fuck?
They're smart animals, man.
They went after his donkey. They're like, this is a warning, motherfucker. We're gonna eat your tea leaves, whether you like it or not.
He warned him. He just stomped this poor donkey. Oh.
They're smart, man.
Mm. Yeah, there also, there was the elephant. So my dad's cousin, he's technically my great uncle, I guess, but he raises elephants for like temple ceremonies and stuff like that. There was a specific elephant that hated the veterinarian, and as soon as the veterinarian would come up, he would recognize him and start throwing shit at him, just full chucking. Nice. And if you get hit with something that an elephant chucks at you with its trunk, you're gonna die. You're gonna get hit in the head and you're gonna die. So these things are so smart. You just don't give them credit for it.
I mean, if you think about it, back to the kangaroo thing, kangaroos are just deer that spent time in prison.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Oh, my.
And on that note.
It's time to end.
Yeah, I was going
to
say, on that note.
I think it's time to end that one.
All right. Well, episode 5, gentlemen. Not too bad. I'm pretty happy with the conversations that we've been having lately. I like it a lot. I think they're thought-provoking, but also humorous at the same time. To all of our listeners out there, thank you, first off, for listening. Really appreciate all of your support. Obviously, we're just getting started, slowly encroaching on the 100 download mark. Verified downloads. There might be more on the side, but...
at the Tarek Web.
Yeah, we really appreciate it. So, you know, do us a favor. And if you're comfortable with it, just start letting your friends, family, anyone else that you think might enjoy this, let them know. Start really boosting our ratings here. And hopefully as we get more and more people, we can start giving you a little bit more or better content in the future. So,
absolutely.
Yeah, for now, what do you guys think for next week? What do you want to do?
I think a good transition from this would be cryptids. You want to talk about cryptids, or do you want to go more serious topic?
The cryptids. Fall of Rome.
Ooh.
Ancient civilizations.
Ancient civilizations.
Yeah. Ancient civilizations are pretty dope.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's do ancient civilizations.
Guys, if you're listening out there, and there's specific topics that you want us to talk about, we're always happy to put them into our next episode, but please reach out using our social media websites or reach out via email, just so we can get an idea of what you guys are looking for. Of course, we're not going to change who we are and how we talk about things just because somebody wants us to. That's never been us, and that's never been the point of this. So if there's a specific topic you want to talk about, great, let us know. If you got opinions on something we did wrong, sure, let us know. Just don't expect us to change everything. We will rescind and redact commentary if we find out we said something incorrectly, as I did today. It's just that's a personal decision to make. It's not something to do with, you know, how we want to run the podcast. We're a bunch of drunk idiots talking about different topics, so sometimes we get it wrong.
Speaking of which, that shot went down the wrong pipe.
That's all about part of the learning process too, right? Like we said, we're not experts. Ouch. So no. Maybe we could even have a segment at the beginning of every episode where we can say, hey, we got this email where they let us know that this was actually the truth. And now we all learn too, right? Mm-hmm. So then we'll know for the future.
Absolutely. Call us out. Just don't be dicks about section. It. We'd like to apologize to Senor for this comment that we made. So sorry.
But yeah, other than that, thank you again, everybody. We really appreciate you. We like it when you hang out with us, and we hope that you like hanging out with us as well. Other than that, I'll leave you with this. Stay ordinary, friends.